So let's figure out how we get the doctrine of salvation. Let's go to Revelation 1 and 1. One scripture, verse 1.
The revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave unto him, to show unto his servants things which must shortly come to pass. And he sent and signified it by his angel unto his servant John.
Okay, so John is a Jew. He's an Israelite. And he was sent by an angel. Let's go to Psalms 147, chapter 19. Chapter 147, verse 19. We're going to read verse 19 and verse 20 so we can locate what's going on.
He showeth his word unto Jacob, his statutes and his judgments unto Israel.
Jacob's name was later changed to Israel. I'm pretty sure you all know that. Keep going.
He hath not dealt so with any nation.
So he hath not dealt so with any nation except Israel.
And as for his judgments, they have not known them. Praise ye the Lord.
So we can't go to Italians that has not been taught by a Jew to learn anything that has to do with this Bible. It has to come directly from a Jew. That is set in stone. That's in here. It's in your book too. Are you finished with that?
Yep.
Let's go to 1 Peter chapter 2. Verse 1.
Wherefore, laying aside all malice and all guile and hypocrisies and envies.
Where you at? 1 Peter chapter 1.
Oh, chapter 1, verse 2. Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father.
Go to verse 1. Pick it up at verse 1.
Peter, an apostle of Jesus
Christ.
There
we go. Okay.
To the strangers scattered throughout Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia.
So Peter's a Jew?
Yes, sir.
All right, keep going.
Elect according to the foreknowledge of God the Father, through the sanctification of the Spirit, unto obedience and sprinkling of the blood of Jesus Christ. Grace unto you, and peace be multiplied.
Blessed words coming from that brother. Keep going.
Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead.
Mm-hmm. Keep going.
To an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you.
Well, now, let me just jump in there, because he says he begotten us again to a lively hope. So there ain't no once saved, always saved. You hope to get salvation, and that's through the blood of Jesus Christ.
Let me jump in. Give me Romans 10 and verse 1. And when you get there, brother, go ahead. Brethren, we about to jump into the salvation the real way. Let's do this. Romans 10 and verse 1. Go ahead.
My heart's desire and prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved.
Wait, so this prayer to God for Israel is that they might be saved. He's going to tell you why. Go ahead.
For I bear the record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge.
So they have a zeal of God. They are passionate about serving their God, but it is not according to knowledge. Keep going.
For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and going about to establish their own righteousness.
Wait, they being ignorant of God's righteousness, which is the real way that you're supposed to get salvation, and they going about to establish their own righteousness, saying, oh, you're going to get salvation this way. Keep going.
Have not submitted themselves unto the righteousness of God.
Now keep going.
For Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believes.
True statement. Keep going.
For Moses describeth the righteousness which is of the law, that the man which doeth these things shall live by them.
Keep going.
But the righteousness which is of faith speaketh on this wise, say not in thine heart, who shall ascend into heaven? That is to bring Christ down from heaven.
So he said, look, it ain't going to be no excuse. He said, look, it's not what you say in your heart. Who shall ascend into heaven to go get Christ down from above? Keep going.
Or who shall descend into the deep? That is to bring up Christ again from the dead.
Go ahead.
But what saith it?
What saith it?
The word is nigh thee.
The word is nigh thee. So it is no way where you cannot get around this word, right? Keep going.
Even in thy mouth.
It's in thy mouth.
And in thy heart. That is the word of faith, which we preach.
Now keep going.
That if thou shalt confess with thy mouth the Lord Jesus, and shalt believe in thine heart that God hath raised him from the dead, thou shalt be saved.
Now, skip down to verse 13.
For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Keep going.
How then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed?
That's a good question, right? Keep going.
And how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard?
So how they go call on him which they have not
not believed, and how shall they believe in him of whom they have not heard? Keep going.
And how shall they hear without a preacher?
How they gonna hear without their right preacher? Keep going.
And how shall they preach except they be sent?
So now, how you know he's sent? Because the preacher of the Lord is gonna tell you, keep his laws, statutes, and commandments.
That is correct.
That is how you get salvation. Revelation 22nd chapter. Revelation 22 and verse 14. Go ahead.
Blessed are they that do his commandments, mm-hmm. that they may have right to the tree of life.
Who is the tree of life?
Jesus.
But back up to the first, back to verse 12. Let's see what it says real quick.
And behold, I come quickly, and my reward is with me.
Has anybody got that reward yet?
No, sir.
Is anybody that ever died, come out of that grave, and went to heaven?
No, sir.
And if we are in agreement on that, I'm good. But if you say your salvation is now, why would the book say he that endure to the end the same shall be saved? Because let's look at something. Let's go to Joel's second chapter. Joel 2. And we're going to pick it up at verse 1. Joel 2. And verse 1. You get to go ahead.
Blow ye the trumpet in Zion,
and sound an alarm in my holy mountain.
Mm-hmm.
Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord comes,
for it is nigh at hand.
So now, we talk about the second coming of the Lord. That day is not came yet. Okay, go ahead.
A day of darkness and of gloominess, a day of clouds and of thick darkness, as the morning spread upon the mountains, a great people and a strong, they have not been ever the like, neither shall be any more after it, even to the years of many generations.
Now, has this happened yet?
So,
we know that's future. Okay, skip down to verse 11. I mean, verse 10.
The earth shall quake before them. The heavens shall tremble. The sun and the moon shall be dark. And the stars shall withdraw their shine. And the Lord shall utter his voice before his army. For his camp is very great. For he is strong that executeth his word. For the day of the Lord is great and very terrible. And who can abide it?
So now, who can abide that day? Those that keep his commandments. Because if you're not keeping the Lord's commandments, you are his enemy.
That's right.
And let's see what happens to his enemy. Skip down to verse 30.
And I will show wonders in the heavens and in the earth, blood and fire and pillars of smoke. The sun shall be turned into darkness and the moon into blood before the great and terrible day of the Lord come. And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered.
Wait a minute now. You got to call his name when?
At
the beginning of the time. Because that's what he say. He that shall endure to the end shall be saved. But if you don't do what he say do, he going to tell some people, hey, they're going to come to him and say, have we did all these wonderful works in your name? You know what he's going to say?
Depart
from me, workers of iniquity. What is an iniquity?
Sin. That's right.
What is sin?
1 John 3:4.
So that's the biblical. Let's get the biblical definition of sin. Because that shouldn't even be an issue in any debate when it comes to the Bible. But apparently it is, because most people think the Holy Ghost is going to guide them to do everything that they do. And all they got to do is follow what the Lord say. And breaking a commandment is not a problem.
First John 3:4. Whosoever committed sin transgresses also the law. For sin is the transgression of the law.
Wait a minute, that ain't nailed to the cross?
No.
So if a person can say, I am not a sinner because I don't have no law, then what is the transgression of the law?
Sin.
And if you are transgressing, you ain't got nothing to say to the Lord when he comes, because you're going to get judged just like in a court of law. You get judged on what? The law on the books.
And
right?
And in the first chapter, verse 4, it says, he that saith I know him and keepeth not his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him.
So now, if somebody's telling you the truth, that person been sent. If somebody's not telling you the truth, they are not sent from the Lord God of Israel.
That's right.
God of Israel.
And I got a precept on that. Let's go to Acts, the second chapter. Let's go to Acts 2. And we're going to pick it up at verse 19. Get right to it.
And I will show wonders in heaven above and signs in the earth beneath. Blood and fire and vapor and smoke.
We just read that, didn't we?
Mm-hmm. and the sun shall be turned into darkness, and the moon into blood before that great and notable day of the Lord comes.
So that day is coming.
Go ahead.
And watch what happened on that day.
Go ahead.
And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved.
Wait a minute, I got saved back in 2010. We talking future, right?
Yeah.
And we talking about a set time when the Lord gonna save his people, because that's what his name means, saving.
And
when he come, he will save those that do his will.
And let's clear up one thing. We heard you say black Hebrew Israelites. Black is color. We are the children of Israel. We are the lost tribes of Israel. We have not located the tribes until the Lord come and redeem us.
Mm-hmm.
And we're not the Israelite group that say only Israel going to make salvation. That's not the case. Isaiah 56 in verse 6. We'll get them. The salvation is for anyone who grab a hold to the covenant, not just for us. We just the teachers of it. We supposed to be an example. But we are not. We are hidden prison houses. We are the first killed. We are the last hired, first fired. We on the bottom of the totem pole. We the bottom feeders because we did not hearken to the voice of the Lord. Isaiah 56, verse 6.
Also, the sons of the strangers that join themselves to the Lord.
The sons of the strangers. Anybody outside the nation of Israel, Africans, Hamites, whatever they want to say. I know you guys been dealing with some folks. We ain't them. We true keepers up in here. Keep going.
To serve him and to love the name of the Lord, to be his servants, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting.
They keep his what?
They
keep Sunday.
No. They keep the Sabbath.
The first day of the week?
No. The seventh day of the Sabbath.
Amen.
And take it hold of my covenant.
Keep going.
Even them will I bring into my holy mountain.
Even them, he going to bring them well?
To my holy mountain. And make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar. For my house shall be called a house of prayer for all people.
Some people.
All people.
So we not affiliated with the black Hebrew Israelites. That's not us. This is the Church of Israel.
I got a precept on that. Give me Ezekiel 18. Ezekiel 18, and we're going to pick it up at verse 4.
Mm-hmm. We'll get that going. Behold, all souls are mine. As the soul of the Father, so also the soul of the Son is mine. The soul that sinneth, it shall die.
So the soul that sinneth, it shall die. So we talking about that soul, that one that you, the soul, the sin, the Father ain't going to be responsible for the sins of the Son. The Son ain't going to be responsible for the sins of the Father. How you going to get in that kingdom? You have to follow the law, statutes, and commandments. Give me 1 Peter 4 and verse 15.
But let none of you suffer as a murderer, or as a thief, or as an evildoer, or as a busybody in other man's matters.
Go ahead.
Yet if any man suffer as a Christian.
Wait, he's suffering as a Christian. What is a Christian? Somebody that follows Christ, right? Go ahead.
Let him not be ashamed.
That's something you should not be ashamed about. Go ahead.
But let him glorify God on this behalf.
Go ahead.
For the time has come that judgment must begin at the house of God.
Wait, it started at the house of God? It started in the church. Go ahead.
And if it first began at us.
If it first began at us, we're supposed to be the ones that really following this thing, right? If it first began at us, go ahead.
What shall the end be of them that obey not the gospel of God?
Ain't that so?
So that's the question we pose to you guys. We don't know what your beliefs is on salvation, but we pose that question to you. And keep going. Go ahead.
And if the righteous scarcely be saved, where shall the ungodly and the sinner appear?
Mm. But now let's look at something else. Let's go to John the 6th chapter. And see when this salvation is going to come. So make sure everybody know when it's coming. Because we read about the last days when the Lord return. He's going to deliver these people. Okay, John 6. And we're going to pick it up at verse 38.
For I come down from heaven, not to do mine own will, but the will of him that sent me.
Mm-hmm.
And this is the Father's will which has sent me, that all of which he has given me, I should lose nothing, but should raise it up at the last day.
When is it going to be raised?
At the last day.
That's the day of your salvation. Everybody's ever been in the grave, still in the grave.
Yep.
That's why we understand why people go to the cemetery and talk to the ground. Because the dead know nothing. Okay, read the next verse.
And this is the will of him that sent me, that everyone which seeth the Son and believeth on him may have everlasting life, and I will raise him up at the last day.
Skip down to verse 44.
No man can come to me except the Father which has sent me draw him, and I will raise him up at the last day.
Now, how have you drawn to the Lord? By his word, right? It's the word that begets you. And when you are begetting by the word, you change. And you change your lifestyle. You start keeping what? Commandments. Just that simple, okay? Skip down to, what's the next one? 54?
Whoso eateth my flesh and drinketh my blood hath eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day.
Ain't that something?
Time.
Well, let's see what else with that eternal life. Skip down to verse 63.
Time.
Oh,
okay, we got time. Now we're on to Metro Praise International. We're not going to go for any more than 15 minutes, and then if, within y'all choice, if y'all want to do a cross-examination, we can do that. Or we can do the final words for each side.
No, we'll do the final words. You want to do the final words, and then we go cross-examination.
Yeah, okay,
All right, we're ready? One, two. Microphone is on. Is it on? It's on. Get a light.
Okay, it's on.
One, two, okay. All right, so we believe in Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, you are saved by grace through faith, not of works, lest any man should boast. So we do not believe we are saved by anything other than faith in Jesus Christ. And then it says in Ephesians 2:10 that you are the workmanship or handiwork of God, created, past tense, in Christ Jesus to do good works. What do you have first, a birth or a child learn arithmetic? You can only have the birth first, then the child learns arithmetic. You have to be born again first to do good works. You have to be saved and recreated. John 3:3 says, for no one can see the kingdom of God unless they are born again. Now, please get ready for Galatians chapter 3, verse 10, because you guys are talking about the law as if you're following it today. So I want to help you out here today. If you think you're following the law of Moses, we're going to go through some of them. I have all 613 here on my computer, and I've broken them down in different categories. So we're going to see how you're doing with Galatians chapter 3, verses 10 through 12. Good sir, please read it.
For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse.
If they're under the works of the law, what are they under?
The curse.
So if someone here says they're under the works of the law, what are they under?
The curse.
Okay, for it is written.
For it is written, cursed is everyone that continueth not in all things which are written in the book of the law to them.
Cursed is how many?
All.
Cursed is how many?
All.
Everyone. Everyone that continueth not in how many things?
All things.
How many things?
All things.
So everyone who does not continueth in all things which are written in the book of the law to do them. Verse 11.
But that no man is justified.
How many men are justified by the book of the law? How many?
No man.
No man.
That no man is justified by the law in the sight of God. It is evident.
It is evident today, and I will show you, you cannot follow the law. 613, every one of them today. You are under the condemnation of that law. Continue.
For the just shall live by faith.
How many will live by faith?
For the just.
The just. So if you want to be just, you have to do it by faith. We're getting some feedback here. I don't know if it can handle.
Keep it away from them. Just keep it away. Yeah. Right there.
Okay. We are justified by faith. The just shall live by what?
By faith.
Verse 12. And the law is not of?
Faith.
What is the law not of?
Faith.
Faith. Keep reading.
And the law is not of faith, but the man that doeth them shall live in them.
Shall live in them. So how can I live in obedience to Christ if the law puts me under a curse? We must have a redemption from the law of Moses and brought into a new covenant. Read verse 13, please.
Christ hath redeemed us from the curse of the law.
He redeemed us from the curse of the law.
But he made a curse for us.
What was he for us?
A curse.
Amen. Keep going.
For it is written, cursed is everyone that hangeth on a tree.
Verse 14.
That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ. That we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith.
Through works of the law?
Through faith.
How do we receive the promise of Abraham?
Through faith.
Through faith. Now I want to break down 613 laws for you in categories that would help you. There are 22 laws that have the Hebrew word olam. That means forever. They are commanded to be done forever. 22 of them. Let's go through just a few to see if you are keeping these laws today. Are you today sacrificing? Are you today bringing first fruits to the temple? Today, is there a table of showbread in the tabernacle? Are you in a priesthood that blows trumpets? Are you offering the priest certain offerings? Are you giving them the sacrifices of animals? And are the ashes of a heifer being brought before you? If you say Jesus fulfilled these, then you just made our point, sir. You are not saved by the law. You are saved by faith in Jesus Christ. Unto, as we'll get to in just a moment, the law of Christ. The law of Christ is the fulfillment of the 613 laws. Now, those 22 you cannot fulfill, but maybe 20% of them. Another 29 commandments are given with the word throughout your generations or forever. Once again, you can only keep a quarter of those. I don't see tassels here on your robes. I don't see you enacting a civil law for homicide, safe cities. I don't see that you are today honoring the Lord with the sideburns. You're supposed to allow the sideburns to grow up. These laws to you are a conviction because the Bible says that the one who does not continueth in all of them is under the curse of the law. And then let's go to Sam with the law of Christ in Galatians.
Just for the record, I'm under the assumption because as pastor addressed it, you are promoting observance of the law of Moses. That's my assumption because you talk about the Sabbath and so forth and so on. So I'm operating under that assumption that when you say the law, you mean the law of Moses is still binding on followers of Jesus Christ. Because like I said, we're learning what you believe as we go along. So with that assumption, I think the pastor here did an excellent job of showing that it is impossible to live the law to God's satisfaction to obtain immortal life. I'm going to add to that. Let's go to Acts 15. Let's read verses 1 to 11. Here you have a group of Jews. Because remember earlier, our brothers in humanity over here said that since the law has been entrusted to the Jews, then we need to hear it from a Jew. Well, you don't get more Jewish than Peter. And Peter says, the law of Moses saves no one. You are purified by faith, by the grace of Jesus Christ, not by the law of Moses, which is a yoke that neither they nor their ancestors were able to keep. Acts 15, verses 1 to 11. Read it for me, my friend.
And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren, and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phoenicia and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy unto all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church, and of the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that God had done with them. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed, saying that it was needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses.
So you guys represent the Pharisees. We represent Paul and Barnabas. Let's see who Peter agrees with.
And the apostles and elders came together for to consider of this matter. And when there had been much disputing, Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us, that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us. And put no difference between us and them by purifying their hearts by faith.
By faith in keeping the law or by faith?
By faith.
Now notice what he says about the law of Moses, which you're trying to enjoin upon us. Gentiles are not ethnically Jewish. Keep reading.
Now therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear?
So why are you trying to tempt God by forcing us Gentiles to keep a law that even the Jews say neither us nor our fathers have ever been able to keep, which is why we are saved how?
By faith.
But keep reading.
That we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they.
If that wasn't clear, let's see what Paul says to a group of Jews in Acts 13, 38 to 39. Does he agree with our brothers in humanity here, or does he agree with what we believe, because what we believe comes from them, not from the traditions of men, or twisting scriptures to our shame and destruction? Acts 13, 38 to 39. Here's what Paul says to Jews. Acts 13, 38 to 39.
Be it known unto you, therefore, men and brethren, that through this man is preached unto you the forgiveness of sins, and by him all that believe are justified from all things.
By him, all that believe and keep the law?
Nope, by those who believe.
By believing in Jesus, you are justified. And continue.
And by him all that believe are justified from all things from which he cannot be justified by the law of Moses.
Sure sounds like Paul is preaching what Pastor Joe is preaching, not what our brothers in humanity happen to be preaching. But then again, if that's not clear, let's see what Paul says to Gentiles in Acts 16:30 to 31.
All right, verse 30. And brought them out and said, "Sirs, what must I do to be saved?" And they said, "Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house."
That must be a typo, because Paul should have said, "Believe and keep the law, and you and your household will be saved."
Amen.
Why does Paul sound like Pastor Joe and not our brothers in humanity at the table over there?
It's from the Bible.
So let's go to Galatians 3, verses 1 and 2. Let's see how a man is justified, how a man is saved. How does a man receive the gift of the Holy Spirit that leads to eternal life? Galatians 3, verses 1 and 2.
All foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you, that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you. This only would I learn of you. Receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by hearing of faith?
So according to them, it's by the works of the law. Paul says, no way, Jose, it is by hearing the gospel and believing in Jesus Christ. In case we didn't get it, now read Galatians 3, verses 5 to 9. Just in case we didn't get it.
He therefore that ministereth to you the Spirit and worketh miracles among you, doeth he it by the works of the law or by the hearing of faith?
So how do you get the Holy Spirit?
By
the miracles?
By faith.
All right, now continue reading. How about Abraham? Was Abraham justified by keeping of the law, which came 430 years after him?
Nope.
Read 6 to 9.
Even as Abraham believed God, and it was accounted to him for righteousness.
Now that must have been a typo. Even as Abraham believed God and kept the law of Moses, which came 430 years later.
No typo. Know ye therefore that they which are faith, the same are the children of Abraham. And the scripture, foreseeing that God would justify the heathen through faith, preached before the gospel unto Abraham, saying, indeed shall all nations be blessed. So then, they which be of faith are blessed with faithful Abraham.
Now read 14 real quickly, because my time is running out. Read
14. That the blessing of Abraham might come on the Gentiles through Jesus Christ, that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith.
Through faith, not law, not faith in law. Through faith in Jesus Christ, who completes and perfects the law, and it's his righteousness that I obtain by faith that justifies me before God. Another thing I've noticed is that you keep emphasizing the future aspect of salvation. And I don't think any of us deny there's a future aspect to our salvation. Because after all, what is Christ saving us from? The wrath to come. But we can know right now by faith that when that day of wrath comes, we will escape it because we have trusted in Jesus Christ. Go to Romans 5, verse 1. So I appreciate you emphasize the future aspect, but let's emphasize the present reality of the salvation that assures us that when that day comes, God's wrath will not fall on me because the blood of Jesus Christ covers me to his glory, honor, and praise.
Amen.
Romans 5, 1.
Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God.
We have or we shall have?
We have.
What kind of peace do you have if you still fear God's wrath to come?
No peace.
So that means true peace comes from knowing without doubt when that day comes, God's wrath will not be poured on you because you have trusted in Jesus Christ. Verses 9 to 11.
Verse 9. Much more then, being now justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if we, when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God by the death of his son.
Shall we be reconciled, or are we already reconciled right now?
We were.
Shall we be justified, already justified right now?
Right now.
Keep going.
We were enemies. We were reconciled to God by the death of his son. Much more being reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only so, but we also joy in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom we have now received the atonement.
Now we receive, or we shall receive, the atonement that appeases God's wrath, guaranteeing us that when that day comes, God's wrath will not be poured upon us.
We received it.
So then, of course, we don't deny there's a future aspect to our salvation, because after all, God came in the person of his Son to save us from the day of wrath. That day is future, but I can know right now, by trusting in Christ, not the works of the law, that day of wrath will not affect me, according to 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 9 to 10. Read it for me. 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verses 9 to 10.
Verse 9. For God hath not appointed us to wrath, but to obtain salvation by our Lord Jesus Christ.
Praise the blood of Jesus that gives us the assurance of that day.
who died for us, that whether we wake or sleep, we should live together with him.
Now, according to Christ, if I believe in him, shall I ever die? John 11:25-27. I'll read it. Jesus answered her and said, I am the resurrection and the life. He who believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And he who believeth in me and lives shall never die. But according to you, someone who believes in Christ can die if he fails to observe the law of God according to his satisfaction. So your gospel is a different gospel from the one preached by Jesus in John 11:25-27. Pastor, I'll give it to you.
Yes, and so we clearly state what the law of Christ is. You think we're lawless? No, we're under the law of Christ. Romans 10:4 says, for Christ is the end of the law for righteousness to everyone that believeth. The law is believe in Christ and obey him. And that is the law of Christ in Galatians 6:3. For if a man thinketh himself to be something, he is nothing. He deceives himself. In so doing, fulfill the law of Christ. Our clock was a little different than yours.
No, thank you. Y'all got 25 seconds. It's okay. 20 seconds.
She got eager.
Okay, so are we going to do the cross-examination then?
Let's end the 10 minutes and do this. Open up.
Yes, I think they respond with 10, we respond, they cross.
Okay.
Thank you.
So final words. I guess.
Let me go first. Let me go first to James 1, first chapter 1. Because the problem around is, you know, if you just have to believe it, just have faith, that is not enough. Bring this mic down a little bit.
Feel free to set the mics and stuff, because they're all, can we get them all together? Is that okay?
Well, I'm not sure what's going on, but this one just, if I got to have that far back, that's not good.
Yeah, right.
But let me go to James 1, because I'm losing time. James 1.
No, I'm so sorry. So can you start this time over again? I really want to take care of the mics, because it's causing issues. I don't want to take over in your house either, but I don't think that's fair to you or to us.
Okay, bro. Yes. I appreciate it. Okay. Yeah. James 1 and verse 14.
Okay, we started over.
Do you have another? Do you have another wired mic as well?
Matt, are you so demanding?
James 1, chapter 14.
No. James 1, chapter 1. And I'm sorry. James 1.
Is it James 1 or James 2?
No, James 2 and verse 14.
James 2, chapter 14. James chapter 2, verse 14. What doeth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and have not works?
Like, what works is he talking about? Just believe? Is that all you gotta do? So look what he's gonna tell you.
Can faith save him?
Can faith save him? That's all you need right here. It's some faith and you're gonna get in. And when the Lord comes with his wrath, he's just gonna pass it because you believed in my name. That ain't gonna be enough. The devil believed that. He read that earlier. Right? Go ahead.
If a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say unto them, depart in peace, be ye warmed and filled, notwithstanding ye give them not those things which are needful to the body, what doeth it profit? Even so faith, if it have not works, is dead, being alone.
Bottom line, right? Yes. But now, let's look at something else. Let's go to Philippians, the second chapter. Philippians 2. Because you said if you don't have to fear nothing with the Lord, then you should be able to get, you don't believe in nothing. Let's see what the Bible says. Philippians 2 and verse 12. Go ahead.
Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed.
Always what?
Obeyed.
Okay, go ahead.
Not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling.
Whoa. So if I know I'm working my salvation out, I'm doing his will and his word, and I'm still worried I might fall one day, because Paul even tell you something. He said what? I might be a castaway, right?
Yep.
Let's go read that. Let's go to 1 Corinthians 9 chapter. 1 Corinthians 9, and we're going to pick it up in verse 24. Because if you got peace and you say, how can you be cast away? Didn't Moses tell the Lord to blot me out your book? And Moses said, no, I'm going to blot those out that don't do what I say out this book.
Know ye not that they which run in a race run off, but one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown. But we are incorruptible.
We are incorruptible. Go ahead.
I therefore so run, not as uncertain, so fight I, not as one that beateth the air.
See, I ain't fighting with the wind now. I'm making myself do what I know what I gotta do. Keep the commandments. Okay, go ahead.
But I keep under my body and bring it.
Get too close to the mic.
Bring it back with the mic out.
But I keep under my body.
Bring the mic down.
Right.
Okay, go ahead.
And bring it into subjection.
Uh-huh.
Lest that by any means we have preached to others.
When I have preached to others,
I myself should be a castaway.
How could you be a castaway? If you fall from the truth, because if Paul said, if you break the law, you know, he said, you're a sinner, right? Mm-hmm. But now what he's saying? Let's go to Romans the 7th chapter. Romans 7. And just see what Paul say about the word of God. We're going to put that mic down. Just use this mic.
Yes, Lord.
Romans 7.
Just say yes, Lord.
Romans 7 and 7.
What should we say then?
Uh-huh.
Is the law sin?
Mm-hmm.
God forbid.
So now y'all make it seem like the law is sin.
Yeah.
What's wrong with thou shalt not kill?
Right.
Thou shalt not steal.
Yeah.
Thou shalt not commit adultery.
Yeah.
But no, I got faith. I'm gonna have your wife tonight, and I'm gonna be faithful tomorrow. Right? But if I got works, my works gonna keep me from going to your house to mess with your wife. Right?
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Nay,
uh-huh.
I have not known sin but by the law.
Don't sin but by what? Is this the New Testament?
Yes,
this is after Jesus' resurrection?
Yes, sir.
Is that after you sit on the right hand of the Father?
Yes,
why are we still talking about sin? That's works, right? Okay, go ahead.
By thy known lust.
Uh-huh.
Except the law had said, thou shalt not covet.
Uh-huh.
But sin,
mm-hmm.
taking occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence.
Mm-hmm.
For without the law, sin was dead.
Uh-huh.
For I was alive without the law once.
Mm-hmm.
But when the commandment came,
uh-huh.
sin revived,
mm-hmm.
and I died.
Uh-huh.
And the commandment which was ordained to life,
mm-hmm.
I found to be unto death.
Doing what? Kill that old sinful body,
that's
right? Okay, go ahead.
For sin,
uh-huh.
taking occasion by the commandment,
mm-hmm.
deceived me,
uh-huh.
and by it slew me.
Uh-huh.
Wherefore the law is holy,
uh-huh.
and the commandment holy,
uh-huh.
and just and good.
Yeah. Ain't that something? 1 John 2 4, and verse 4. Then I'm
we gotta read verse 14.
Go ahead.
For we know that the law is spiritual,
mm-hmm.
but I am carnal, sold under sin.
Uh-huh. Now, 1 John 2. Verse 4.
Okay.
Give me my
1 John chapter 2, 4.
Mm-hmm.
He that saith, I know him,
mm-hmm.
and keepeth not his commandments,
uh-huh.
is a liar, and the truth is not in him.
Whoa. Is that Peter? John? Paul? Who?
Also,
John the Revelator.
Yes, it is. And let's go read something else John the Revelator said, because you all say that you don't have to worry about nothing as long as you're born again and have faith. This is what I'm reading here in Revelation chapter 20, verse 13.
Mm-hmm.
It say, and the sea gave up the dead which were in it, and death and hell delivered up the dead which were in them.
Mm-hmm.
And they were judged, every man according to their works, not their faith. And death and hell were cast into the lake of fire. This is the second death.
Mm-hmm.
And whosoever was not found written in the book of life, you better find out what you need to do to get that book of life, was cast into the lake of fire.
Now, let me clear up something real quick here, because they said when Jesus died, we still only under the Mosaic law. No, we're going to Daniel 9 chapter real quick. I'm going to show you what happened when Jesus was on the cross, and when he died, what happened is why we don't have to keep some of the Mosaic Levitical priesthood law. And that's Daniel 9, and we're going to pick up to verse 27 to get right to it and see what happened when Jesus was cut off. I want 27, but because like I said, we got 27. Read 26, the first part. Go ahead.
And after 62 weeks, mm-hmm. shall Messiah be cut off.
So now, cut off mean what? Kill, right?
Yeah, right?
Now, go to verse 27. They can read that on their own.
And he shall confirm the covenant with many for 1 week.
Uh-huh.
And in the midst of the week,
mm-hmm.
he shall cause the sacrifice and the oblation to cease.
So now, if we don't have to sacrifice no animals no more, that's what was nailed to the cross. But let's confirm. Let's go to Matthew, the 25th, 7th chapter.
Let's go there.
Matthew 27. Because he didn't nail the Sabbath day to the cross.
Nope.
He didn't kill that. Only thing he killed was the animal sacrifice, but the animals, he never warned them in the first place. Matthew 27:51. Go ahead.
Jesus, when he had cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. Uh-huh. And behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom.
Now what that represents, that's where you go into the holy place, right? Right. And you bring the sacrifice, but the veil ripped. Right. Man didn't cut it, the Lord cut
that's
it.
Right.
And it ripped from top to bottom. Go ahead.
And the earth did quake, and the rocks rent.
Now what happened because of that? Because the Lord ended the Levitical priesthood, which he's going to reinstitute when he comes back. And then the strangers can bring their offering. And now let's go back to Galatians, because that's where y'all started. So let's clear up something, because I think y'all skipped a lot over there.
Yeah.
See
it quick?
Well, let's do it real quick. In Galatians 3. And we're going to pick it up in verse 1. We got to find out who Paul's talking to. Because Paul's an Israelite. Talking to the Galatians.
Okay.
Galatians 3 and 1. Go ahead.
O foolish Galatians, who hath bewitched you that ye should not obey the truth, before whose eyes Jesus Christ hath been evidently set forth, crucified among you?
Go ahead.
This only what I learned of you. Receive ye the Spirit by the works of the law, or by the hearing of faith.
Now, what law is he talking about? We got to find out, because he ain't talking about all the law. He's going to talk about the works of the law. Okay, go ahead.
Are ye so foolish, having begun in the Spirit? Are ye now made perfect by the flesh?
Now, he's talking about some flesh, right?
Yes, sir.
So, what are you talking about? Animal sacrifice. Because they want to still keep the sacrifice. But Jesus ended that. We just read that, right? Now, skip down to the part where you just skipped over. He said, because it was added because of transgression, right? So what commandments was added because of transgression?
Sacrificial
law.
That's right.
Right? So now, we don't have, let's read verse 18. Go ahead.
For if the inheritance be of the law, it is no more of promise.
When Adam sacrificed to save you, it is no more of promise because you got to have faith. Okay, go ahead.
But God gave it to Abraham by promise.
And what he said, do what I say and walk before me further. Right? Go ahead.
Wherefore then serveth the law? It was added because of transgression.
Now, was the Ten Commandments added because of transgression? No. It was in the beginning. Because the Lord told us, remember the Sabbath day.
And the Lord gave them laws to Moses.
Exactly.
Time.
Okay.
Thank you. Time to have some fun.
That was very clear.
Passage you quoted out of context and or misinterpreted, and you even misrepresented what we taught. For example, we're going to have fun right now, we're going to laugh together. It shocked me you read Romans 7 and you didn't even finish Romans 7, because in Romans 7 Paul says, because of sin, it's impossible for him to do the law to God's satisfaction. Now let's see what happens when we read those passages in context so we can all have a good laugh.
Amen.
Go to Romans chapter 7, let's read 7:25. So thank you for making my case for me by going to passages which you misquoted. Now we're going to quote them in context.
Amen.
Romans chapter 7. Remember he said that the transgression meant sacrifices. On the contrary, the law was given not for the sake of sacrifices for transgressions, but the law was given to make known what transgression is. That's exactly what Paul says in Romans chapter 7. Read 7 all the way to 25.
What shall we say then? Is the law sin? God forbid. Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law.
That's what it means the law was given for transgression, to make you know what sin is. You twisted that to say that it was given for the sins committed that needed to be atoned by sacrifices. You can laugh.
That's not what we said. That is not what we said.
Gentlemen, I did not cut you off. Gentlemen, I did not cut you off. Let me repeat what you said. It's recorded. You said that transgression in Galatians 3 meant transgressions in connection with sacrifices for transgressions committed. That's exactly what you said. But Romans 7 says you don't know what you're talking about because that's not what it means by transgression. Let's read it again. What transgressions was the law given to manifest? It was manifested to us that sin is X, Y, and Z. That's what it means that the law is given for transgression, not for sacrifices for transgression. Finish it.
Nay, I had not known sin, but by the law. For I had not known lust, except the law had said, thou shalt not covet. But sin, taking occasion by the commandment, wrought in me all manner of concupiscence.
Whatever that is, man.
Uncleanliness. Uncleanliness. For without the law, sin was dead. For I was alive without the law once. But when the commandment came, sin revived, and I died. And the commandment, which was ordained to life, I found to be unto death.
So you mean the commandment of God, which was meant for life, brought death to Paul?
Correct.
And this is the chapter they quoted to prove that Paul says you need to keep the law?
Correct.
The very law that said that ended up killing me dead because of sin in me?
Yes, sir.
And this is their proof text?
Keep reading.
Of course. Keep reading because you're going to see it's Jesus, not your law, that saves you if you keep reading to 25. Keep reading.
Romans
10. See, God was angry with us. What is the verse? Start at verse 9.
Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. But where sin abounded, grace did much more abound.
You're not reading Romans 7.
I got verse 9.
Right?
Sorry about that.
For I was alive without the law once.
Then when the commandment came, sin revived, and I died. And the commandment which was ordained to life, I found to be unto death. For sin, taking occasion by the commandment, deceived me, and by it slew me.
So sin used the law to kill Paul?
Yep.
So was Paul able to live the law?
Nope.
Thank you. Keep reading.
Wherefore the law is holy, and the commandment is holy, and just, and good.
Keep going.
Was then that which is good made death unto me? God.
What, by the way, pay attention when they laugh. That means they're losing, because we didn't disrespect them and laugh at them. So we're going to laugh back. Keep going.
God forbid that sin, that it might appear sin, working death in me by that which is good. That sin by the commandment might become exceeding sinful.
So what does it mean that the law is given for transgression? Sacrifices for transgression or to make known what transgression is?
To make known.
Thank you. Keep going.
For we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin.
Bam! Right there. I am sold under sin, which is why I cannot keep the law, because it requires someone spiritual to keep it. Now let's continue, my brother.
For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I.
Does that sound like you can keep the law to God's satisfaction?
No.
Keep going.
If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. For I know that in me, that is, in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not.
So Paul says, I have the desire to keep the law, but I don't have the power to do that which is good. Therefore, the very chapter you quoted actually proves our point. No man can be saved by the law, which is why he ends it with, praise be to God, the Father, for sending the Lord Jesus Christ to do for me, which I could not do for myself.
Amen.
So the very chapter you quoted actually proves our point. And you did it with Philippians chapter 2, verse 12. Let's go to Philippians 2, 12. Let's read the next verse, which you did not quote. And by the way, for the record, for all of you from Metro Praise, do any of you think the law is no good?
No.
No.
Do you think the law is bad?
No.
Or do you think the law is spiritual and good?
Spiritual.
Do any of you believe that once, because you're saved by faith, that means you can live lawless?
No.
Or do you take
no.
that to mean that now that God has saved me and given me the Spirit, I now desire to keep the law to bring Him glory, but not for salvation?
Amen.
So all you did was attack straw man misrepresenting our position.
Amen.
Because that's all you can do, because you can't refute us, because we're speaking the truth. Philippians chapter 2, verses 12 to 13.
Wherefore, my beloved, as ye have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation.
Does it say work for your salvation?
No.
Nope.
That's how you misread it. Working out is not the same as working for. Working out means make manifest that which is already in you, the salvation of God. Because God has saved me, that will be manifested in a transformed life. But let's see how He does it. Let's continue 13, which you did not read.
For it is God which worketh in you both to will and to do of His good.
Bam! If you're born of the Spirit, who then puts the desire in you to want to live that holy life and give you the power to do it?
Lord.
So why did our friend here not quote verse 13, he signed verse 12? And then you did the same thing with James 2. I'm here astonished how you quote so many passages out of context. Let's go back and see what James' point is in context, not taking one or two verses out of context. Let's go to James 2, 14, and read the entire context.
Verse 14. What doth it profit, my brethren, though a man say he hath faith and hath not works? Can faith save him?
For the record, did you remember when Pastor Joe cited Ephesians 2, 8 to 10? Let me remind you what he cited at the beginning of his talk. He said, for it's by grace you've been saved through faith, and this not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. But then he read verse 10. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. That's all that James is saying, that if you're truly saved by grace through faith, that will result in a transformed life of obedience to good works. So how does James 2 refute us when we actually amen James all the way to glory? If you truly have faith that saves, then that faith that saves will manifest in obedience to the law, not being lawless. See, all you've done tonight is misrepresent our position, because you don't know our position. And if you knew our position, then you change your position to worship the Holy Spirit and know the law saves no one but the blood of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
You didn't finish me, bro.
Okay, let's go back. I'm going to now correct this.
You didn't need to,
but it's all right, because I'm going to go read Romans 7, because now it's going to refute you. You want to read it all? I'll try to be a little merciful, because I love you, but it's all right. Let's go down to Romans 7, start at 17. Let's read on.
Start at verse 14.
Oh, even better. We read 14, but for your sake, we read 14.
Well, we know that the law is spiritual, but I am carnal, sold under sin.
Does that help this case or our case? If the law is spiritual, but you're carnal and a slave to sin, can you keep that which is spiritual?
Nope.
Keep reading.
For that which I do, I allow not. For what I would, that do I not. But what I hate, that do I. If then I do that which I would not, I consent unto the law that it is good. Now then, it is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me.
Keep reading, brother.
For I know that in me, that is, in my flesh, dwelleth no good thing. For to will is present with me, but how to perform that which is good I find not. For the good that I would, I do not, but the evil which I would not, that I do.
So does that help this case or our case? Keep reading, don't stop, because let us finish it, because I want to see 8:3 what the good news is.
Now if I do that, I would not. It is no more I that do it, but sin that dwelleth in me. I find then a law that when I would do good, evil is present with me. For I delight in the law of God after the inward man, but I see another law in my members, warring against the law of my mind and bringing me into captivity.
If you're taken captive, how are you free to do the law to God's satisfaction?
None.
And you wanted me to read all of this, right?
And bring me into captivity to the law of sin which is in my members. Oh, wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from the body of this death? I thank God through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Bam! It's Jesus Christ our Lord that saves me, not the law. So read Romans 8:3 so we can end it, because we got 30 seconds. Keep reading.
8:3. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sent His own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin, condemned sin in the flesh.
The very chapter you wanted me to read proved we're right, and you need to repent, because you do not teach biblical doctrine. It is Jesus and His blood that saves, not the law. Good luck trying to satisfy God by your obedience to the law.
Okay, now we're going to do the cross-examination. This is going to go for... Who is it?
10 minutes.
It's 15. Look, so how do you want the format? Do you want to just... We ask a question?
The way that I prefer it is that the questionnaire directs the questions, and the questionee cannot answer a question and can be cut off if the questionnaire wants to continue on. Okay. So it's not my, like if I'm being asked a question, I can't talk for 10 minutes and take the whole time.
Right.
You could say, thank you. Because in my understanding, the cross-examination is making your point through what I believe, basically. And so it's not my time just to go on and on and on. But if you're abusing the questionnaire, he can ask the moderator for space and say, I'm not getting a chance. Like, say somebody's leading you in a question and keeps wanting you to say yes. At some point, maybe it's not a yes or no question. Like,
question is asked, we're going to give a 2-minute limit for the answer.
Yeah, something about
Let's do this. Let's do this. Because it's getting too far detailed, because I wasn't prepared you guys were prepared.
Okay.
Because, like I said, from the beginning, I thought this would be dealing with young guys and your group, and that's why I didn't want to get involved.
Can I apologize for that?
By the way, for the record,
like I said, if I'd known the pastor was coming, I'd have been sitting down here for a
minute. Just to let you know, I don't have any prepared speeches. I just went off the top of my head.
I always try to get myself ready for any kind of time.
We agree. But you accept my apology?
I just don't appreciate him saying, get down and repent, or do this, repent. We never said that to you one time.
We try
to be humble and be nice, and that you went there, you went there. Okay. So I would say, I would like to schedule a re-debate, and we do it with me from the beginning, and we start this thing, You and me? Go, and now I know where you start. Now I know where you at. And you go first, and then I'll go second.
Okay,
we
yeah,
get
me,
first.
Go, do it.
So, I don't care if it's you, a whole group, 10, 20.
No, no, just
it
me.
It don't
me.
Matter.
No, just me and you.
That's fine. That's fine.
Well,
that's fine. You want the master's or the PhD, or is it?
No, actually,
okay, it don't matter.
I'm a spirit trainer.
I just have, like I said, I'll take you two, and me and my brother will go with you two.
Okay, beautiful.
Beautiful?
Let's set it up, yeah.
All right, we'll schedule that.
For the record, I got anime when you guys started laughing at me, so you started.
Oh, well, you did it first. You started
first.
That's not
right.
We have a recording.
I have.
And
I'll tell you why.
So,
I'll tell you why.
Wait. Let me say this. Because I have, let's be clear,
it was during the Trinity discussion
exactly.
where you said that we had to worship the Trinity in the way that you all worship, but you said that in a way of where it was
your argument was that's not the truth.
So then I do say that it was not necessarily necessary for any laughing to be going on this side. So with the cross examination, let me just make this clear. With the cross-examination, since we were not able to do it properly when it came down to the 10-minute final words, we have to do it properly within the cross-examination if we want to be able to reach someone within the different camps. So we can be able to make these points and not necessarily come off as if we're mocking each other within it.
Okay. Do you forgive us?
Oh, we forgive 70 times 7. One thing that I want to say. One thing that I want to say is this.
Yeah.
The original format of how everything was set up does not matter from this point on.
Yeah, because you...
We forgive you. Let me finish.
Okay.
We forgive you, whatever. Like, but I will say this. It's about reaching everybody here and giving them an actual format to see something like this.
Correct.
We don't see a debate every day.
Correct.
And that's why I said, I accept whatever. Juan called me, whatever. I accept. Let's do it.
Okay.
But if we gonna really do this thing... With this cross-examination, I believe we need to do 15, 20, 20.
Sure.
However you guys want to do it.
Sure.
You said you asked the question. How do you want to do it? You want to ask the question first? Or?
Sure. Can we just make sure we're in peace?
Sure. Absolutely.
Nothing to worry about coming here.
Thank you.
Can we end it at 10, though, if it's okay? I mean, because it's already 9:30.
Well, we're going to end it now.
We'll just reschedule the thing and start from scratch.
All right,
that's fine.
And that way we know the format next time around.
All right, you got it.